Let me tell you about when I was 13 years old. My best friend played me the track YYZ off of Rush's Moving Pictures album, and it absolutely blew my mind. He was already a drummer, and I had been playing trumpet for a few years before that, but when I heard this track, I knew that I had to do whatever it took to get a bass in my hands and become a bass player. Insane unison lines played at incredible speeds. Amazing solos by the bass, the drums, and the guitar. This crazy exotic sound capped off by a big keyboard section. It was impossible, and it made me really excited and want to play the bass more than ever. Now, if you've visited my channel before, you know I'm a jazz bass player, and what I talk about mostly on this channel is jazz music. It's what I do as a professional and what I've done for years and years. But make no mistake, there's really no this without this. So today, I have two goals with this amazing music. Number one, to break it down 30 years later with much older ears and analyze why I hear what I hear and why does it sound so cool. Secondly, to see if I can do the impossible, to play the song I could never play at age 13, this time on acoustic bass, because why not? And in the end, maybe we can actually answer this question about YYZ. Does it jazz? Let's find out. Right away, tritone interval, the devil's interval. How many other people went to music school and used this song in music theory when you had to identify a tritone? Just me? Am I the only one that did that? Now, right away, this is an awesome line. There's no chords happening, but if you listen to the synthesizer, it's heavily implying a C7 alt chord, which is a very common type of harmony that happens in jazz. Assuming that we're in the key of C, the keyboard is actually outlining an altered C dominant 7 chord, so that's kind of jazzy. Yeah, this unison lick is like ridiculous, right? Now, if we break it down slowly, it's almost an altered scale or a super Locrian scale. We use this scale in jazz to play over altered dominant chords. Again, it's the sound that they set up in the beginning of the song, C7 alt, and this scale is just an extension of what the synth was playing in the beginning. Can I say that I'm in my 40s and this music still gets me excited? Let's call this section A. This is our first thematic material. We're really going between two chords, although right now it's a unison line. The bass and the guitar are playing together. So in jazz speak, we might call this NC. NC standing for no chord. But what's being implied here are pretty much F sharp minor to A minor. A really tricky line, especially on acoustic bass. The string crossing here is no joke. section, this is where we really get into the meat of the song and the tonality. B chord to C chord, one half step away. There's a lot of tension there between those two chords. It's really exotic sounding, but these guys play over them amazingly and with a lot of great technique. Now, if you listen to the melody, which is really cool, you're actually hearing a B dominant seventh chord outlined in the notes of the melody. In fact, he goes to the 13 after he plays that dominant seventh chord. It's really powerful, and when you add to that Geddy playing behind him with those double stops on A and E, it's really a huge sound. Rush has had a reputation for sounding like they're 10 guys, and this is why, because they know how to make the music sound huge with one another. Now, from what I can gather, the C chord they keep going to sounds like it's major. Geddy is really informing us around C with his fills. He's going up to the D, which is the ninth. He's going to the A, which is the sixth. He's also throwing a lot of B natural in, which screams C major 7 with an F sharp, C major 7 sharp 11. So it sounds to me like we're going from a B chord to a C major 7 sharp 11, including what he's going to play later in his solos. Really well constructed. Okay, let's call this section B2. It's the same chord changes, B to C, like I said before. They're playing off of this theme. This was the section that really did it for me. And we hear them play three bars a band, one bar a soloist. First bass, then drums. That happens twice. Then three bars a band, two bars a soloist. This is actually from jazz. This is a jazz convention. You can hear this in big band music, where the group is trading with the one soloist. So there's a little jazz there too. Now Geddy is crushing this. He's soloing over the C chord of the section. And like I said, he's very strongly implying C major 7 sharp 11. He's playing E's and D's, B naturals, A's, F sharps. Alex, on the other hand, is playing straight B triads until one of the sections where he implies B dominant seventh and C dominant seventh. If you listen really hard, you can hear it in the guitar line. Now, this section of music was so impossible to me for so many years, but now I know what the changes are. I wondered what it would sound like if I were to put my own fills in the style that I think of right now, like more jazz oriented. Jazz over this. Okay, let's go to the guitar solo now. We're gonna call this section B 3, because it's the same chord change as we've been dealing with in the last two sections, B to C. Here's part of the genius of Rush. It's something called orchestration. The chord changes stay the same, but everybody is changing their parts to make each section sound new and fresh, especially the great Neil Peart on drums. What he's doing is amazing from section to section. He's playing three distinctly different kinds of things over three sections that have the same chords. It's remarkable and amazing. Now, if you listen to jazz at all, what Alex is playing over this section should sound very familiar to you. He's using a scale that we utilize quite a bit in the music. This is a scale called the Phrygian dominant scale. Also known as the Spanish scale, I've also heard it referred to as the klezmer scale. This is a scale that works particularly well over altered dominant. So you get a really awesome sound that starts on the root, moves up to the flat 2, then you get a major 3rd, a 4th, a 5th, a flat 6th, and a flat 7th. Now, you jazz fans out there should know this is the kind of sound we hear right away when we hear tunes like La Fiesta by Chick Corea or Flamenco Sketches by Miles Davis. Those songs use that scale extensively. Again, C major 7 sharp 11 is heavily implied in the bass fills. Geddy is playing all those juicy notes that outline that chord. Probably my favorite part of this whole section is at the end. Alex gets to play his own two-bar solo, just like Geddy and Neil did in the previous section, and he perfectly outlines that Phrygian dominant scale using the open string. I think that when people say they hear a kind of an Eastern kind of flavor to the sound, they're referring to this scale being utilized by Alex in this section. Here's our bridge, the big synthesizer part. This is what we call in jazz a pedal point. That's when the bass note stays the same and the chords on top change. I already said it. Rush can sound like 4 or 5 guys, and they do it in this section, which is a perfect change up to that B-C tonality we've been dealing with before we go back into the wicked unison line again. So we revisit the A section. In music theory, sometimes it's called a ritornello, sometimes it's called a recapitulation. That's when our original material comes back. It might be modified a little bit. We hear that in what Geddy is playing. There's slight variation to what him and Alex are playing this time around. It's just as hard though. In the brilliance of the coda, we revisit our tritone material from the introduction of the piece and then resolve to B. It's really incredible, and I always feel like I just ran around the block after I heard this song. It's exhilarating. So what's the final verdict? Obviously YYZ rocks, but does it jazz? I have to say, yeah, I pretty much think it does. I'd love to know what you think in the comments below. Is this idea worth revisiting on another song that maybe does jazz on the sly? Let me know what you think. And if you like the video, please smash that like button. And if you're not a subscriber and you like all original stuff coming at you just about every single week, then hit that subscribe button. Don't miss my next video. As always, thanks for watching, and please love your neighbor.